Wow. Okay, I've taken ages to do this, like the whole summer. But welcome to Thingcast episode 3 with me, London Electricity. An epic episode. I'm catching up with so much great new drum and bass, and also my guest of this episode is none other than Dom Whiting, the drum and bass DJ on a bike extraordinaire. His interview is after the music. Let's go.
I've been on my way down. I've been living with the lights out, getting troubled by the idle sounds of the day to day. I know I let you down. I did nothing to protect you. Didn't know how much you went through, and now it's too late. I wish I did more to love you. I wish I did more to keep you safe. And if I only could, I'd build a better world.
And we are building up to the release of my next album, which is Rebuilding Better Worlds. My selection of remixes from the Building Better Worlds album. And we're kicking off with Hugh Hardy's amazing remix of Build a Better World, featuring Ema Dineen, of course. Shout to Ema, shout to Hugh. Totally nailed it on this one, Hugh. It's so effortless. I love it.
Weighs heavy on me now, thinking about all that you went through. Doing anything to numb your way to an empty space. Staring at the ceiling, trying to figure out a meaning. Trying to buy into the feeling of a better place. I wish I did more to love you. I wish I did more to keep you safe. And if I only could, I'd build a better world for you.
Resist it, I'm sorry. It's like a form of Tourette's. I have to join in. Sound of Mike Kiss, Grief in Puddles. We'll be right back. Big shout out to Johnny Mike Kiss coming through as a mature artist in drum and bass, aren't you, Johnny? You're always pretty grown up, actually. I'm sorry it's been a long time since Thingcast 2, but I've been kind of really busy totally reorganising my studio and I'm loving it. It's actually the most creative studio I've ever had. So I can't wait to actually start making music and to bring new music through. Very, very exciting. Couple of shouts to Mitch Ross 997, who says, yes, yes, Tony, loving the Thingcast. So good to be able to hear you unabridged and free. Can't wait to hear the new remix album. I hope you're on the mend. Yeah, spiritually I'm on the mend, but physically I don't know really. It's what it is, it's all good. Coming, it's as if I think it's pronounced like that, and this is called Unpopular. It's wicked, check it out. Coming, brand new music from Athena, a lovely tune called Bayside Groove. Now, as I'm recording this portion of the Thingcast, my guest, Dom Whiting, is doing an absolutely huge mass cycle loving, drum and bass loving through London. It's a big deal. News coverage on ITN News. And it's nice to have something that people from the rest of the world, something that's happening in England that people from the rest of the world can actually look at and say, do you know what? They're not all totally stupid in England. Because right now, trust me, particularly in Europe, everyone is eating their popcorn and watching the United Kingdom implode. Which is fine, because sometimes an implosion is very important, you know? You got to get rid of the old dead wood before you can rebuild. So it's all good, that has to happen. Oh yes, now I haven't played anything from this project. Probably because I've been doing other stuff over the summer, but this is one of the best remixes of Sub Focus. In case you missed it, this is by Boo, and the tune is World of Hurt. My pleasure to play at least two new cuts from Royalston from his forthcoming album. I don't wake up alone. Pray I don't go. This is the first one. This is Won't Go, featuring Janie.
I'm sick of looking after me and you, baby, that's true. If you had a clue, you would have seen it coming. Come a little closer, come a little closer. Did you tell me a lesson or two? So honey, I owe you. So come a little closer, come a little closer. Not gonna try for you, so sit tight. Expect me to hide from you, oh, I try. You don't want to, won't go, oh, won't go, won't go, won't go. Not gonna wait for you, who will pass by. Leave a key at the door as an invite. You won't go, won't go, you won't go, won't go, you won't go, you won't go. Sorry for what? Getting caught. Next time, leave the door locked. Or don't go, don't go. you would have seen it coming. Come a little closer, come a little closer. But you taught me a lesson or two, so honey, I owe ya. So come a little closer, come a little closer. What can I try for you? So sit tight, expect me to hide from you. Oh, I tried, you know, won't go, won't go, won't go.
One of the many things I love about Royalston, who's one of the most exciting producers in drum and bass, is the way he builds up to his breakdowns and the way he executes them like you would not expect. Check it out. This one of my all-time favourite tunes.
Mister, no, 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 no. People in a sorrow, thinking about today, but them nothing about tomorrow. Oh, what type of life are we living? Murderation, raping, and killing, and sin, sin.
It's of course Signs, the Calibre remix. Bad Martian Shree. And it's one that I've been playing quite a lot recently. Shout out to Vlad Polaris, one of the amazing remixers on the Rebuilding Better Worlds project. Cyfreak02 who said I'd love a shout out to the Dubai Bassworks crew. And everyone here in this minuscule scene doing their best to represent and keep it alive. On that tip, shout to Tiffany Bowley. Major drum and bass head from New Zealand. Who's currently in the UAE. Keep it locked to the Thingcast. Oh yes, it's the sound of Zero T. Modified. And this is part of the Noam Chomsky project. Shout out to Kian for sending this over. Coming. Brand new from Royalston again. Now this, I think, is either out next week or maybe out now. This is called Eris. Check it out. It's gorgeous. Absolutely fucking brilliant from Royalston. Love it. out, yeah. Ooh. Let's see what the maestro does with this break now. From the Neon Dust album, this is brand new Etherwood. They're here. Another former med school alumni coming correct. Okay, yeah, let's dip into Neon Dust now. With a trio of Etherwood tunes. Massive shout out to Etherwood's hair. It's coming along nicely. Big love to the Woodster, one of the nicest people, not only in drum and bass, on the planet. Neon Dust. Woody teams up with Fred V. to make this. It's called Nebula. Shout going out to Jay Centric and the Conjunction Recordings crew. To what Kate is made of, who says, so pleased to hear the next Thingcast is on its way. They brighten up my day. And Josh SYR, who says, hey Tony, I'll be listening in while on my shift at the firehouse in Indianapolis. and the album Neon Dust is out right now on Hospital Records. Album Woody came with a bunch of demos, and this one really, really stood out. I'm so glad it's on the album. On the podcast over the last few years, we're now at the demo stage, Askel and Elere, and they now have an album on Solvent, and a very interesting album it is too. I'll play a couple of cuts from that album, and this is them teaming up with Inmost for a tune called Cherry Yoga. Now, it's completely irrelevant, but cherry yogurt is my least favourite form of yogurt. That said, this is not my least favourite drum and bass tune. And Prismatic says, much love and big shout out to you, Tony. Thank you. Ian Allsop, 101, says, a shout out to all the lads on the Gulf Oil platform in the Persian Gulf. Oh, the Gulf. Yeah, G-O-L-F. Oil platform in the Persian Gulf. Would be great. And shouts in from Planet Bjorn. From Bruno B. Alanta. Retro Peter says, holla, Peter here from Derby. From Derby? Ooh. Spinning the wheel, it's Stacey with Russian Doll. Stace. Running things all the way from South Africa. I've got to give a shout out to Joel Plus One from the Scratch Perverts, who lives in the next road to me. And as well as being a world champion turntablist, you should check out his Instagram page, by the way. As well as being that, he's a qualified electrical engineer. And he has the best attic studio that I've ever seen. Wall-to-wall vintage synths. Anyway, he popped over to have a look at my Space Echo because it wasn't working. And he got it working. Absolute don. And Christian Seagart says, Tony, I love your Space Echo. I love my Space Echo too. The Carrot Cruncher says, yes, shout out to the Carrot Cruncher, please. How good is Woody's new album, eh? Sublime. It absolutely is. Peter Scott Creative says, give us a shout out. I love the new podcast. Keep it up. Shout out to the Analog Speedbird. Brave little toaster in the house. Shout in from the Twisted Twins. Shout in from Brett Ionosphere. Now, when you've been supporting an artist for a while and they come through with a tune that you believe is definitely going to break them, it's an amazing feeling. And this is one such tune. Check this.
A hater told me that you're never gonna make a legend. It's guilty by association, so I cuffed his brethren. My words are worth the weight in gold, I know you won't forget them. Nobody's sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in. A hater told me that you're never gonna make a legend. It's guilty by association, so I cuffed his brethren. My words are worth the weight in gold, I know you won't forget them. Nobody's sticking to the code, at times it does my head in. Does my head in, yeah, does my head in. Nobody sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in. Yeah, does my head in, yeah, does my head in. Nobody sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in.
It does my head in, just imagine. Fans call me legend, hate to say it has been. It does my head in, I need a bloody aspirin. 2020, everybody's body
rocking. You see the things that you portray, everything you're not. In the city where we're from, they'll take everything you got, whether you wanted it or not, yeah. Whether you wanted it or not, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And when you are not the person you betray, things will surely worsen, it's a burden to be fake. Whether you wanted it or not, whether you wanted it or not.
A hater told me that you're never gonna make a legend. It's guilty by association, so I cuffed his brethren. My words are worth the weight in gold, I know you won't forget them. Nobody's sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in. A hater told me that you're never gonna make a legend. It's guilty by association, so I cuffed his brethren. My words are worth the weight in gold, I know you won't forget them. Nobody's sticking to the code, at times it does my head in. Does my head in, yeah, does my head in. Nobody sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in. Yeah, does my head in, yeah, does my head in. Nobody sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in.
It does my head in, just imagine. Fans call me legend, hate to say it has been. It does my head in, I need a bloody aspirin. 2020, everybody's body rapping.
From the new EP by ThinkTonk on Space Cadet Records.
It's getting boring, man. Let's talk about.
Does my head in. Picture DRS.
You see the things that you portray, everything you're not. In the city where we're from, they take everything you got, whether you wanted it or not, yeah.
And Ragoel.
Whether you wanted it or not, yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's doing my head in, I need a paracetamol. They don't wanna battle cause they know I'll beat them all. It's doing my head in, I need a ibuprofen. They don't wanna crash cause I'll write and follow them.
Nice.
It's doing my head in, I need a paracetamol. They don't wanna battle cause they know I'll beat them all. It's doing my head in, I need a ibuprofen. They don't wanna crash cause I'll write a father death.
A hater told me that you're never gonna make a legend. It's guilty by association, so I cuffed his brethren. My words are worth the weight in gold, I know you won't forget them. Nobody's sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in. A hater told me that you're never gonna make a legend. It's guilty by association, so I cuffed his brethren. My words are worth the weight in gold, I know you won't forget them. Nobody's sticking to the code, at times it does my head in. Does my head in, yeah, does my head in. Nobody's sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in. Yeah, does my head in, yeah, does my head in. Nobody's sticking to the code, sometimes it does my head in.
It does my head in, just imagine. Fans call me legend, hate to say it has been. It does my head in, I need a bloody aspirin. 2020, everybody's body rocking.
You know,
mash up on a line.
Incoming. Brand new music from Simplification. Working with Camargo, this is Fluid. Shout going out to Brett Ionosphere. And BD Mac 90 says, I'm reading all the shouts, by the way, I didn't vet this at all. Shout out to all the people that voted Brexit. Hope they can now start to see the impact of their actions and how much we need the support of migrant workers. Hashtag what a shit show. I think you all know my opinions about that by now. So for those of you who came down to Hospitality in the Woods, in Beckenham Park, I really hope you enjoyed yourselves. I had to go straight in and out to do my set because I was on crutches. I'm still kind of working through, trying to work out what's causing me so much pain in my hips and back. I've had one hip replaced, but the pain's come back. Anyway, I'm going to hospital tomorrow. They're gonna do another procedure on my spine. So we'll see. It is what it is. What will be, will be. But the woods, from what I can see from the photos, because I couldn't walk around the site even, but it looks like it was amazing. Loads of little nooks and crannies. You could sit up on a hill and watch what was going on, hide in the forest, all sorts of things. I was going to say, I don't know how I've managed not to play this, but I've only done 2 podcasts since May. That's why. But from the remix album of High Contrast, this is Time is Hardcore, remixed by Breakage. Massive shout out to Lincoln Barrett, aka High Contrast. in the game from the very beginning, almost the very beginning of Hospital Records. From the year 2000, I think we released his first track. Yes, Lincoln. So many special memories. Yes. Massive tune from TI with one, an even massiver title, Bongolian Belt Roller. And Ollie Ho saw, Ollie Ho says, saw you at the woods the other day and had a great time dancing and catching up with my hospitality friends. Would love a shout out to all the ferals out there. A shout to Tom Darville, who says, happy Sunday, I'll have a shout. Why not? To Maxim Kostenko, who says, shout out to all the listeners from Kyiv in Ukraine. He says, I wanted to buy the latest album on CD, but I'll have to buy another new remix album too. Good luck, thanks for your love and passion. Yeah, my passion is, it's growing by the day, actually. Incoming, the psychotic sound of Mozey. waiting room. Get ready. Massive shout out to Mozey. And you know what? I've spoken to Mozey so many times. I actually don't think I know his first name. Can I call him Arnold? Arnold Mozey. Anyway, shout out to Arnold Mozey, who is feeling ill at the moment and had to miss his souped-up set because he ended up in A&E with really bad sinusitis. Okay, back to Askel and Elere territory. From their album, this is great. It's the last track on the album, but possibly my favourite. It features Winslow, and it's called Taking Forever. Good to meet the boys, very briefly, at Hospitality in the Woods, backstage, and also Duncan Winslow, who flew over from the United States on his first ever international flight. Yes, Duncan. It's the sound of Foreign Concept, the Champagne Nihilist. That's a really good image. Someone who believes in nothing, quaffing champagne. Quite a few of those running our country at the moment. Another all-time classic that's been burning a hole in my ears recently. Hatir Us, Spaced Invader, the J Magic remix. Everyone is getting ready. To properly brock out, let's do this. And this tune is a perfect example of building up tension, releasing it, and then suspending you in the breakdowns. It's amazing. We'll be right back. we go. Love that. No rush for the bass to come back in. The music just has to do its own thing. One of the absolute tunes of the summer by Unglued. This is Sunbathing in Space. Massive shout out to Josh Unglued. Yes, mate. Killed it with this album. Shout out to Nick Plain. Tom McKnight says, shout out to my Mrs. Louise for getting us tickets to Hospitality in the Woods. And massive shout out to you guys at hospital for throwing one of the best raves I've ever been to. So much love there. I just fucking love hospital events so much. Thank you, Tony. I've got to give a shout out to Lopez, David Lopez, who runs the hospital shop. Put on such a good spread at the hospital shop in the woods. Best shop ever. Absolutely killed it, David. David, I apologise. And you could do much worse than check David's own clothing brand, the Very High Energy Group. Check it out, it's wicked. We'll be right back. from an album that I believe will be really the only choice for Album of the Year at the Drum and Bass Awards. Because it's a brilliant album and it was positioned perfectly.
They don't get no plaudits from the audience, and we ain't hearing no applause from the auditorium. I snuck it in my jacket, had it stashed inside the inner lining. Couple shots I got them oscillating, we ain't synthesizing. Trying to make a couple notes, that's how we got them gliding. Trying to slide on this society, we ostracizing. We ain't city center living, now we're in the bits. Came to put them in the deep sleep, it's the anaesthetist.
Paula and Bryson, the anaesthetist, featuring Strats. Production levels absolutely fantastic.
When anything we're dealing with easier, they be the evilest. Anesthetics putting them to sleep is the anaesthetist. Man are getting buried, if anything will be ferried off the Caribbean Sea, off the coast of Central America. Automatic whips, so it's changing gears and you didn't hear it. Fully did it and didn't have any interfering. Looking up and we couldn't ever see any ceiling. Life is dark when we're living, it'd be forever evening.
And if you haven't checked out the Polar and Bryson album, do it. The artwork is fantastic. Proper utopian artwork. I love it.
From the audience, and we ain't hearing no applause from the auditorium. I snuck it in my jacket, had it stashed inside the inner lining. Couple shots, I got them oscillating, we ain't synthesizing. Trying to make a couple notes, that's how we got them gliding. Trying to slide on this society, we ostracizing. We ain't city center living, now we're in the bits. Came up, put them in the deep sleep, it's the anaesthetist.
This, of course, is BC Poodle Dub. Shout out to Nico Martin 1981, who is apparently a drum and bass Twitch community. Big up the Kent Massive, okay. What out going out to Lee DJ Meister Francis. Have a great day, Lee. And Franz Schneider says, can I have a shout to Joe Kieran Marlowe and Amelia Weston Oldham? Your friends have big names. Shout out to you guys. Peter and I just had a drink and look forward to party again together at Hospitality on the Beach in Albania at the festival where our friendship once started. Let's do some English traditions every night. Okay. P.S. Looking forward to Thingcast 3 London Elektricity. You are the best. Tyler and Bryson now.
I wanna get serious.
Shout out to Simon Mill Street and the Last Week Liquid podcast.
I wanna get serious.
It's a great podcast. I was honored to be featured on it recently.
I wanna get serious. I wanna get serious.
Shout out to Daniel Briggs who says, can you give me and my mate Barnaby Sims a shout? How good was Hospitality in the Woods? Adric Summer says, bugger, I may have missed out. Shout out to you, Tony. Hope you're doing well. Sending massive love. Yes, Adric. Adam Fathers says, happy Sunday, Tony. I'm still getting over last Sunday in the Woods because I'm so old. David J says, big up yourself, Tony and DJ Undertaker. Email address, please, for music submissions. DJ Undertaker, wicked. Shout out to Jenna Page. Have a great day, Jenna. Oh, Steve Jeffroy. There we go, BC. He says, yes, Tony. The drum and bass mogul that is BC. And Paul Spiteri says, massive shout out to Loretta from Not So Sunny Jersey.
Yeah.
absolute shout out to Makoto for this. This is the tune that we all hoped he would make. And even though this didn't exist, it wasn't even a glimmer in Makoto's eye when we signed him. This tune is why we signed you, Makoto. Absolutely amazing, featuring Von A on vocals. Yes, Von A. Absolutely brilliant piece of work. What you need. Festival hands in the air, come on. Possibly my favourite tune on the Polar and Bryson album, and it features Hugh Hardy, a man who is on fire at the moment. This is called Vetter. I keep thinking it's called Velour. now. Getting on for the last tune before Don Whiting comes in. I can hear him trying to cycle up the stairs at the moment to my studio. Not a pretty sound. But I want to give a shout out to all the remixers on Rebuilding Better World. On the next Thingcast, that will go in on the album. But thanks for those of you who tried to guess who was doing what remixes on Instagram. You got a couple of them right. But yeah, massive shout out to Hugh Hardy, to Cleeks, to ThinkTonk, to Justin Hawks, to Mozey, Winslow, Lilac, Degs, Mario Key, Logistics, Digital Native, Winey, Willem, Polaris, and Sever. Now, this is The Prescription is Love, remixed by Cleeks. And I won't play all of it, I'll play a bit. Check it out. It's out in a couple of weeks, I believe. Now, hopefully by the time you hear this, I will have posted on Instagram with a link for you to be involved in the music video for this tune. What we need is for you to post a fairly short video clip of you with the thing that you love. The more surprising, the better, let's say. Really enjoyed playing this at Hospitality in the Woods. First play in the world by anyone, and it properly went off. Big shout out to Cleeks. We don't even know who Cleeks are. We know there are three of them. And we know that they have a very good friend who used to be in EastEnders. And that's all I know about them. When you hear this and you hear some of their other stuff, you can't help thinking, are they brand new talent come out of nowhere? Or are they washed up has-beens who have reinvented themselves supremely effectively? I'm going to get killed for that, aren't I? It's all love. Anyway, from one washed up has been to, who knows, maybe another. This is London Electricity, and I'm welcoming a man who has gone absolutely meteoric during lockdown. One of the big stars. It's Don Whiting coming. Okay, now this podcast, this interview was actually recorded about 6 weeks ago, so a lot has happened since then. A lot has changed. Treat it as a kind of historical moment in time, like a sort of, you know, a little kind of snapshot of early August, end of July, that kind of time, and then it'll make sense. Okay. So I am here with someone I've really wanted to meet and get to know over the last few months, because he has become a real positive feature of lockdown, and it's the mighty Don Whiting.
Yes.
Don, what do people call you? Have you got a nickname?
Do you know what?
Or stage name?
So it's weird, like, before the bike, I had a DJ name, which is my middle name, which is Norman. So a lot of my Wigan people know me for that. And obviously when I've come to the bike thing, I'm like, well, I just feel like it needs a bit of a rebrand because my name sounds better. So yeah, people call me as Dom Whiting. Yes. I get loads of messages with just yes. So yes, I think yes. that's what people go by, like, because that's what I say on the streams.
Yeah.
Yes or big up, or so yeah. either Yes Yes Dom or Whiting or Dom Whiting, one of the three.
Okay, so to be decided then.
Yeah,
well, you know, anyone's got any good ideas, send them in.
Yeah, send them in.
So before we actually get started, first of all, just let's get the details out of the way. How can you be found online? What's the best place?
So, yeah, I mean, literally on all socials, just search Dom Whiting. That's Dom, W-H-I-T-I-N-G. I should come up somewhere. You'll see a picture of my beautiful face and probably a couple of snaps of me on a bike.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So, before we get to what you're up to now, or even what you've been up to recently, where did this start for you?
So, it's obviously, I think during lockdown, it's actually the sort of second sort of phase of lockdown. So we had like three lockdowns. So I think after the first phase, like, I sort of worked for myself, running my own car business, and obviously for
Hold on, car business, doing what?
Fixing cars, repairing cars.
Right, so you're a mechanic.
Yeah, that's my trade. So, like about 9 months before lockdown started, like I got made redundant, and I took the decision to rent a place and just like sort of see how that was going, and it's going really well. Yeah. Obviously, lockdown came about. And for a good month or two, I think the first month of lockdown, like before the second or third lockdown, it was really like everything was shut down. There was nobody on the street. Mm. So for a good couple of months at work, I was quite dried out, but you know, you get by. And I think, yeah, like coming into the second phase of lockdown after the first bit of lockdown, I was just like, I normally run an event in town. So
okay,
we couldn't obviously do that. So yeah, I was sort of missing the music a bit, and I thought, right, what can we do? And it actually initially started off with some static live streams. So yeah. The first sort of one that I did was, we got a roundabout in our town. Basically, it's quite, obviously I don't advise, just do it on a roundabout, but it's quite dangerous to get on. And I thought one day I was just like, oh, let's do a set on the roundabout. Let's just do it.
Brilliant idea.
And so the first day I went to do it was a Saturday. As I was going across the roundabout, the police turned up literally as I was lugging stuff onto the roundabout. And she was like, what are you doing? I was like, I'm just going to do, it was an undercover. I was like, I'm just going to do a music set on the roundabout.
Yeah.
And she was completely baffled. Like, she was completely baffled.
I bet she was.
She was like, what do you mean? Like, I've obviously got this lugging this big generator, and it's a wefty generator. Obviously, times have progressed now. I don't have that anymore. But it was a wefty generator, and it was heavy, man. So just everything onto the roundabout. She's like, no, we don't. She said, I don't advise that you do it. I was like, I was like, okay.
Interesting.
So I gave up on that, and then I went to bed that Saturday night, and I was like, I don't know. She said, I don't advise you do it.
Yeah.
I don't advise you do it.
She didn't tell you not to.
Exactly. So, yeah. So I went to bed and I was like, I was really annoyed because like, if I can't do something I want to do, like it just sits on my brain. So I'm like, okay, cool. Woke up the next morning and I was like, forget this, we're going to do it. So got up at like 7:30, 8 o'clock, packed the van, I think about 10, 11. And I think we started about 1 o'clock. I went and scouted out the area for a little bit. And literally at this time, I got somebody to drive the van. Sorry, it sounds a bit ruthless. Drive the van on the roundabout, stop on the roundabout, offload all the stuff, got set up. And yeah, it was going for 2 hours.
Brilliant.
And the police did come and we did have to turn it off.
Okay.
But anyway.
But you've done your stream.
We've done the stream. But yeah, back to where it's come from.
So which town?
High Wycombe. Yeah.
Okay, one of the original.
Yeah.
One of the original kind of like planned cities in the UK.
But yeah, so back to sort of where it stemmed from, like I guess the wacky idea sort of come from that. And I then did another one after that at a McDonald's drive-thru to try and keep it interesting. Then I finished that and I was like, what can I do, like what can I do next, like. And I think it was it's not good to do the streams so often, so it was like those were like a couple of weeks in succession, and then there was like a month where I was like, okay, what should I do? And I went for a drink with my friend. She was like, why don't you try doing it on a bike?
Fantastic.
And then I didn't really take it seriously, to be honest with you. And then, and then actually the next morning I was like, okay, this can work. So off I went, like seeing what bikes were suitable. And this is actually the bike I'm on now, is like the second prototype. The London ones where you can sit in the back and then this one. So I had that one at first and someone was riding it, but I like to be self-sufficient. Like, I don't want to have to rely on people. Like, although you can have people help or whatever, but I then got that bike, did a couple of streams with that, totally successful. But like I said, I wanted to take it like again to another level. Mm. So yeah, I've got the bike I've got now, which is literally me riding it and with lots of people in tow now, which is fantastic.
there's so many angles to this. So you have to be a mechanic or something
to work out.
To actually, because there was that point where you thought, right, your mate mentioned it.
Yeah.
Do it on a bike, and you thought, okay. And then your mind started activating, yeah, didn't it? And the cogs started turning.
Yep.
And you immediately started visualizing.
Yeah, how can I do it?
How can you actually put that into practice? Because most people would go, oh yeah, that's a wicked idea.
And then
I get home from the pub. Oh no, that's long.
Yeah.
Not doing that.
Yeah. Yeah,
but you built a bike.
We did.
You built two bikes.
Yeah, we built two bikes. I've still got the first one. The second one, obviously, is the main one. I've actually got another one coming. Relayer giving me an electric one.
Oh, there you go. You see.
So
yeah,
that's going to be another project now. Like, because the whole building process, like
the electric bike, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But do you know what? I hate to say it, but I think the electric will slightly dampen it. I think people enjoy that I'm riding and working. So
I agree.
So actually, once the electric bike comes, I'm going to have that as a separate project.
Yeah.
And I will use it, but like for the hills, like you see in the videos, like I'm getting literally pushed up the hill. So I'll save it for the hills and I'll still ride, because you know what? I enjoy just being busy and just, you know, not having time to literally see where I'm going, you know, although it's not safe.
Yeah, but
I think riding's...
It all adds to the adrenaline.
Yeah,
of it,
the riding's like quite a big part of it. Like, yeah. I think that's also why, like you say, there's so many elements to it. There's riding the bike, there's the music, there's the interaction. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just, it's endless, the elements to it. But I think that's very important, is the riding part.
You must have a very, very good multi-core processor in your brain to kind of like,
yeah,
to be able to not crash, to be able to not infringe too many regulations, not crash into the other people cycling with you and mix and talk on the mic.
Yeah, it is.
It's brilliant.
It is brilliant.
You're like one of those mad jugglers on with a bass drum on their back.
Yeah, on the unicycles.
Yeah.
It's quite a task, but I've come quite accustomed to it. But I do look forward to standing up and actually laying down.
Doing some sets.
Yeah, because I like being busy and I like not being able to think, but just being able to be like, you know, boom, 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 boom.
Keeps you in the moment,
and it just keeps it fresh. Like, it's, everything's like live, and you just see exactly how it is. And if there's a mistake, then there's a mistake. But yeah, it's quite a juggle.
In the last Thingcast, I was talking to Jumping Jack Frost, and we kind of both arrived at this conclusion together and separately, because to keep in the moment, what you're talking about, you kind of have to switch off expectation
of
what's coming,
and you
have to
know.
Switch off thinking about the past.
Yep.
So if you're... One way to do that is what you're describing, is to be so busy while you're doing the thing that you can only be in the moment.
Yep.
Because if you're not in the moment, you'll crash.
Yeah, literally, like, thank God the brakes work on the thing. But
yeah.
Yeah, no, it's a very good way to look at it. And it's a good way for people to just see how it is, like, at the time.
Really is. So let's rewind way before lockdown. When did you first get interested in music?
In music? I'd say, obviously, I had like a few phases of music. So before like drum and bass, I think I started getting into drum and bass when I was about 15, because I remember when I used to be able to get into... There was this pub on the corner called The Roundabout, and we used to be able to get in, like, you know, and just... And it was the first Saturday of the month. I got into drum and bass then, but actually before that, like, I still am quite like an indie, like, band, like,
yeah,
Two Door Cinema Club, all that sort of stuff. Like, so, yeah, I say music really sort of become a part of me in probably the early stages of secondary school. And then obviously the drum and bass came about when I was about 15, 16, when I was leaving secondary school. Like I say, it was just a local pub down by where I am, and they kitted it out. And then actually from that, drum and bass for about 3 years or 3 or 4 years, and actually I went off drum and bass for about 3 or 4 years and was like a house and techno person.
Yeah.
And then now we're here with the bike. Yeah.
So there's a difference between musicking and being music.
Yeah.
So people who love music are music. But when did you start doing it? When did you start actually mixing?
Mixing. Oh, so mixing, yeah, like 17, I think. Right. Yeah, so probably a little bit later, but yeah, 17s when I went and didn't know how to use them, but I went and picked up some CDJs and Pioneer 850s. I remember I took a 2-hour drive to Bristol, picked them up from some uni guy that literally just needed some money. I was like, sweet, didn't know how to use them, and brought them back and literally just learned. You know what it's like on the 850s? There's nothing to go by apart from the sound, so you just...
I remember when they were the absolute bollocks.
Dog's bollocks, yeah.
You know,
the first USB you could have, call-ups. I still use call-ups. I still set up call-ups. I do hot cues, but I always do call-ups because, I don't know, with the hot cues, I'm just not used to it. I just prefer to press the arrow to call it up and it's just there. And
Yeah,
I don't know. I know.
I do cue points.
Yeah.
Because if I'm doing, you know, before lockdown, I was doing a lot of long sets, like 5-6 hours.
Yeah,
that was my preference.
Yeah.
Because it is a real journey.
Yeah.
You know.
100%.
I think the older I get, I just think that like a short set is hardly getting going and it's finished, you know.
Your brain capacity's probably got such a wide, you're older than me, but
that.
You've got so much music.
Anyone
music
who knows
knowledge.
Me thinks it's strong. Maybe it's strong because it's so full of music. Could be that, you know.
The music is growing bigger, but the rest of it is strong.
Yeah. But cue points are really handy for that when you've got 6 hours of music to, you know, to string together in an order that works for the crowd that you're in front of.
Yeah.
You kind of, I mean, when I played off vinyl and 12-inch on dub plates, I used to do the equivalent of cue points.
Yeah.
Where I'd break down the structure in my mind and I'd scrawl all these kind of, like, I had these codes, like, for breakdown, lead up to the drop, and then, like, 1632 bars until the vocal, there's a V, you know.
Yeah.
So I kind of scripted the structure of each tune really quickly. And then I'd know where I was.
It's
very
much
the same as cue points, really. It's interesting. But back to your journey, and we're very loosely having a topic, followers on this podcast, and it's a bit like being music to musicking. It's like you start off as a fan of music, following people.
Yeah.
And at some point, if things start to happen, you start to get followed, don't you? And I remember the first video I saw of you, and what town would it have been in? On the very first one.
It must have been Marlow, I think it was.
I think it was the one where you were in that kind of rickshaw bike someone was pedaling.
Yeah.
And there weren't really people following you.
No.
But you were kind of like giving shout-outs to people on foot, the odd car, car hooted back.
Yeah.
And even that was wicked.
Yeah.
That was really, really good.
Yeah.
Now, did you know at that point, way back then, did you know that this was building, or did you just think, I don't care if this is building, I just love it and I'm going to do it?
Yeah, so I had no idea at that point. As I say, when I had that first prototype bike, there wasn't really like a... It's not like an end goal. I don't like setting end goals because if you set an end goal and you don't know where it's going to go, or you expect it to, and expecting sometimes is
that
the worst thing.
If
you set something, and you know, of course everything's achievable, but you don't know what circumstances or whatever. But anyway, yeah. So at that point, I never knew. It was when I got the second prototype bike and I was riding it on my own, and I went back to Marlow, and then I did some stupid thing. I was like, if this gets to 1,000 viewers, I'll jump in the river. And it was very cold that day. And I jumped in the river.
Oh god!
And then I carried on as well for an hour after that. So that was. I think that was the start point.
You get that on camera?
Yeah.
Is that on the YouTube
live
video?
All live. Yeah.
Amazing.
All live. But
so that must have kicked it.
I think it did. Like, and I didn't know that. I was just like, oh, like, let's just say it. Like, I don't, it's only really ever got to like 300 or 400, 500 before, whatever. Like, and I don't know. And I guess it did. And it, more people, because of that insane thing I said, like, it did get more people. And then
it went viral.
Yeah.
People started to follow
Yeah.
your Instagram and your Facebook.
Yeah.
So then you could tell them.
yeah, where I'm
when
at.
The next one was.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's
watching,
like a free party, like
watching. Yeah, amazing. Watching this through the lens of the internet in lockdown, it was fantastic because you were like the Pied Piper of Hamelin.
Yeah.
It's like you started off with a pigeon and someone walking their dog going past you, yeah. And then a few people were actually on bikes.
Yeah, coming along
with you. And every time, every new town you went to, there's more and more.
Yeah.
What was the most recent in the UK?
So the most recent one was literally 2 days ago in Nottingham.
Oh, wow.
And it absolutely hammered it down, but we still did it.
Brilliant.
We still had, I was even surprised myself, we still had about, I'd say about 200-300 people there.
Cycling.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Even in the rain.
Did anyone come off?
Did anyone come off?
Is anyone going to sue you?
Do you know what? I haven't come off, but you know what? Safety is quite a big thing, and I don't want anyone to get injured. But I try and keep it at a pace where, like, hopefully nobody can get injured because we're doing like 5 to 10 miles an hour. Yeah. But yeah, everyone, nobody's been like majorly
injured.
Didn't
your decks get wet?
My decks got wet, and I haven't even checked them, but they did stop working by the end. So
I'll say you're in denial.
Sort of, but I haven't checked them. Like,
put them in the airing cupboard.
I think they'll be all right. I turned it off, like, as it got to the end, and one deck, obviously I've got the controller, one deck had stopped working for about 10 minutes of the last ride. The live stream had cut because so much rain was on the phone, so we only got 40 minutes of live.
Yeah.
But we still obviously carried on after that. Everyone was still there.
And you carried on recording.
Yeah, I couldn't. The phone was just completely...
Okay.
Wet and whatever, so yeah, we carried on riding anyway regardless of the video for about another hour, and then about 20 minutes towards the end the left deck just stopped working, so the right deck, and I was like, instead of the mic, I was like, guys, like, we
have
an
expensive one then.
Yeah, well, I don't know, I need to check it. I think it'll be all right. I think it's just once water's in there, obviously I turned it off by the end, so like no further damage can be done. But
so this is a good time to have a little geek out. I mean, Quite a few of my listeners love this sort of thing. Some don't. So if you don't like geek stuff, just fast forward 5 minutes.
Yeah.
But what do you use? Give us a breakdown, a quick breakdown of your gear.
Of the setup, yeah. So obviously we've got the bike, which is a Christiania Danish sort of three-wheeler thing there.
Very nice.
Yeah, they're quite popular in London. And then we've got obviously the main structure, which holds the decks, which is like, it's almost like a piano, like, you know, one of them piano things, one of them things you're in church and, you know, mate's reading it off there, it's a bit curved and it's got like the bump stop at the end of it.
Yeah.
It's that design.
A lectern.
But, yeah, it's that design, but it's welded and whatever, bracketed up.
Yeah.
Music wise, decks and stuff, we've got the RX1, okay. And
the Pioneer RX1. Good piece of kit.
Yeah.
Pioneer, if you're listening, DOMS might be damaged. hint. This is great sponsorship.
Yeah, send one my way or refurbish mine if it's not working. But yeah, and then we actually like record off a phone, and yeah, we've got obviously your RCA to 3.5 for the sound, got a mic which is just a Shure something, not SM58, but it's a Shure something or another.
Can I make it an annoying suggestion? You've got one of these. I think it's got two outputs
for the mics,
the Pioneer. I've got the same on my studio here. Have a backup sound recorder.
Yeah, for the...
Really? Like, I couldn't get working now.
Yeah, well, it does actually have... I can record the whole set from the USB. You literally just press...
Record. Do you do that?
I forget.
Oh, mate,
I actually forget.
Do it, or you can just get one of these sort of...
Yeah, my friend's got one of them. They just put it by there.
Portable sound recorder.
Yeah. But yeah, I always forget.
I mean, you're getting to the point where... Because you put so much effort into each one.
Yeah.
You don't want to lose it, do you?
Yeah, it's...
So, have a backup. My artists on hospital hate me for this. I'm always telling them to back up their computers and back everything up, you know. But, I'm just a bit obsessive about backup.
No, you're right, though, and I do, like, have in my mind... Well, it's just once I get to the city and I get the bike out... like
of the priority.
Oh, it's just like it's not like a big thing, but it's like, okay, you got to put the camera pole in there, make sure the camera's in position, and obviously make sure the sound, the trims and everything, they've all been touched, make sure the master's like, I've got a little bit of a Tippex mark on the master, so yeah. I know that it can't go any more above that because it's for the...
We'll put another one on the USB recorder.
Yeah, so I know.
Put an arrow there.
That's to be done. It's just one of them extra things which...
You use GoPros, don't you?
I use iPhone.
All right, it's for the camera.
Yeah, literally the recording device is an iPhone, and yeah, obviously we've got the cable that goes into there for the sound, and then we've got a little power pack. Everyone always will ask how I get power. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do a complete separate video and show everyone actually.
You're going to break it all down, tear it all down.
But everyone always says to me like, oh, it's a power pack, and believe it or not, there's quite a market out there for the power pack. There's so many different types, but yeah. I just bought the one I did. But yeah, we've got the power pack. Speaker wise, we've got RCF 715, I think. I've just bought another one. And yeah, obviously we've got the pedal power and my leg muscles.
Yeah, and it sounds like a heavy rig.
Yeah, it's. I think there's actually a little bit of something wrong with the bike because I'm really getting tired with riding it now. Like going, I can normally go up hills, but I don't know what it is. I think it's got one of them. It's got a fixie hub, so if you pedal backwards, it works as a brake.
Yeah,
and I like to pedal backwards. Like just generally, like I like to just pedal backwards, and it's like,
then.
And I think there's something wrong with it because I was never that tired before.
Yeah.
So I think I'm going to take that wheel off and put just a normal rubbish wheel on there.
Be a mechanic.
Be a mechanic.
Yeah.
Get the spanner out.
Yeah. So, so far in your career of doing the DJing on a bike, Don Whiting the Pied Piper, what was your favourite to date?
Favorite ride?
Yeah.
Do you know what? It's so difficult because each one has its own element of, okay, this happened to that one.
Yeah.
We had a kid riding a horse in Cardiff. We had matey who had a parrot on his shoulder in Brighton.
Like,
it's just like, it's just crazy.
Brighton was off the hook.
Brighton was off the hook. I really want to go back there. One being because the internet was really bad, but we still had such a good time, but the internet was awful and we didn't get so much footage. So Brighton, I really want to go back to and revisit that, like, because it was just such a good location by the beach, sun's out. So I don't know, it's difficult for me to tell you which one was the best one. Like, arguably you could say obviously Birmingham and Manchester were the more busier ones. Which that obviously brings an element of, okay, that one was really good as well, but it's just so difficult. Like, it's so difficult for me to say. I'd say Brighton was really up there, and Cardiff was really up there. But
sounds like they keep getting better, though.
They are. They keep getting better, but it's about now. It's about, like, I don't know. I'm just thinking about life after the bike, because what
Don't project too far into the future.
But I want to keep it interesting. Like,
yeah.
I want to keep it interesting. And
what about outside of the UK?
Outside of the UK. So yes, that's gonna prolong my life after the bike.
Have you done any yet?
So we've been to Ibiza. Yeah, that was a couple of months ago. Yeah, we went to Ibiza. Like, it was pretty crazy. Like, so
how was it? Was anyone on their bikes?
We had a couple of people on their bikes.
A few mopeds.
A couple of police officers. But yeah. No, it was really good. Like, the only thing I do regret about doing it is, not actually publicising it, because we did it as like a little short documentary.
Yeah.
Which was actually kind of like a thing in itself. Like, we did, before, like, okay, like we're talking about now, how did you do it? The only thing I wish I would have said about it, I was going there, because I put a post up like, oh, okay, I'm here after I'd done it, and everyone was like, oh, when are you doing it? And like, I think we could have had like a few extra riders on there, definitely. But
next year,
and I think it
would. My drive ether goes on until October, doesn't it?
Yeah, maybe we could go back, but
honestly, if club owners in Ibiza,
yeah.
Sort of realised that you were there, that you were a thing, they'd be flying you out there and paying you to ride
to
around publicising their
before
clubs,
the thing,
but
you'd
have to play banging house.
That's alright.
I could play house.
I think that's whilst drum and bass is the perfect fit for the ride, and like I say, drum and bass was my first music that I ever mixed, and that's why I think I can come back to I've come back to it, and I can just play it like I would as best I can on the bike anyway. But I think it's important to be versatile, and I think that's what will continue to hopefully help it grow, because some people might not like drum and bass, or, you know, they might like techno, or they might like
a lot of
like
people house. Don't like drum and bass, yeah, believe it or not.
But we seem to be grabbing all the crowd to come out on the bike ride. But I think
most people do like it.
Yeah, I think once you get on that bike,
all the best people like
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
It's true.
Drum and bass was my first love for music, but I'm glad I had the break from it, because when I've now come back to it, and I've come back to it with better spirits, and yeah. like I want to take it on more. So
since makes the heart grow.
Yeah, fonder. Exactly.
So what was I thinking just? it's gone out of my head. So looking at the future. Obviously you need to nail your name.
Yeah.
One that's going to be watertight and yeah. kind of like
flow on.
I'll get fucked up in the rain yeah. and kind of like take you through any genre.
Yeah, yeah.
Take you through static DJing.
Yeah. yeah.
Mobile DJing.
I think Don Whiten. I think it's going to have to be Don Whiten.
Don Whiten.
I think it has to be, because
it's already kind of that. Isn't
yeah, because yeah. I can't change it now, and I think it's sort of rolls off the tongue as it is anyway. Like, so,
does.
I think I'll keep it at that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's a good shout.
Yeah.
And fix your bike and keep pedaling. That's yeah. my advice, because electric bikes are actually a lot less green than non-electric bikes.
Yeah, exactly.
Funnily enough,
yeah.
everyone thinks, oh,
yeah,
it's electric, yeah, it must yeah. be green. No, it's not, it's because still someone has to make power, the battery. Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, definitely. I think that's the thing, isn't it? It's a bit like I loved DJing, most of all, using records.
Yeah.
Pretty much as old as bicycle technology in themselves, yeah, yeah. you know. That's why it's so hard to get them pressed these days.
Yeah.
But that thing of like having to juggle two different record players that are probably half broken.
Yeah, anyway. Yeah. One's and going faster than the other. Yeah. yeah.
And all of that, because it's very convenient on the RX ones, and you know, using USBs. Yeah,
of course, you take it for granted.
It's very convenient. Yeah.
I mean, I've got on a bike.
But it is about a million times easier.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's no two ways about it. No. It's a hell of a lot easier. Doesn't mean that it's easy to be a good DJ.
No.
But if you are a good DJ, it's much easier on that. USBs than it is on dub plates. Jump.
Yeah.
So, don't get a rocket bike. No. Not just yet. No, come to think of it, maybe you should talk to, like, Elon Musk or Richard Branson and be the first DJ to go into space.
Yeah, I mean, that would be pretty sick. It's funny you say that. I've got some guy, you know them, not the paragliders, but I've got, it begins with a P, but you know, like they got a motor on the back and a big fan.
Oh, yeah.
So some guy, he messaged me, he's like, oh, he's just up the road from me. He's like, oh, do you want to try and do a set on there? Because he's got a twin one.
Sick!
Yeah, and I was like, yeah, like, let's do it. At first, I was a bit like,
that'd be amazing.
Oh, but that would be sick, like, because I'm pretty, like, shit scared myself anyway. But that would just make such good content. And I've seen the frame of it, so hopefully, like, that would be another way to stem off doing some other interesting things.
Yeah,
so.
that might be sick. Big, massive shout to AMC, who seems to moved to New Zealand now. He's there all the time.
Oh no, I see he was just out there now, wasn't he? Yeah,
yeah. Because the last year, New Zealand's been the only place you can do some gigs. So, but he's been there, and he did a DJ set on the biggest kind of bungee platform.
Yeah, I saw
in New Zealand, but he didn't jump.
He didn't jump.
I wanted him to actually, yeah. like, have your kind of setup and yeah. bungee jump.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think
it would all get smashed. Obviously.
I think if. That would have made it's when there's suspense is when people were like, oh, is he gonna jump? He should have been like, I'm gonna jump at the end. And he would have been shitting himself like I would have. I probably wouldn't have done that.
It'd be all about which tune has got a fantastic enough drop to justify going off the edge with me and smashing all the gear. You know, it's got to be the tune with the ultimate drop.
Something
talking
heavy.
About tunes. Have there been any kind of like tunes that have always done it for you on the bike that you keep coming back to?
Yeah.
I know you play a lot of new stuff.
Yeah, I kind of like, it's difficult with the online things.
Backbone tunes, you know.
Backbone tunes, like, I've been like a LSB fan for, that was like our Liquid and Spectrosoul.
Yeah.
But obviously, you find a Spectrosoul, they're no longer, are they? So, but yeah.
They're still doing stuff, though.
They are still doing stuff.
Mm. Yeah.
Okay, interesting.
Dave and Jack, yeah, they're just under different names.
Okay. But yeah, LSB, if you're here, like, I love that tune.
Yes, Luke. Just, shout to Luke.
Yeah, absolutely banger. Banger tune. And yeah, like, I guess like I am getting fed with loads of new stuff at the minute. So, and also when I'm playing the lives, like I have to be careful what I play in case it gets cut off. So I'm trying to dig as much new stuff as I can, as well as keeping it old. But yeah, I'm,
you mean like YouTube strikes?
Yeah, and Facebook. YouTube's not too bad actually. Yeah, YouTube still lets it go, but Facebook, like it can cut it off. But we've been, touch wood, been pretty pretty like good with that. But yeah, like there's another tune, Vibe Chemistry, just brought out. It's called Balling. It's quite a nice tune. I'm a sucker for vocals on a tune, whether it be like a hard drop or a, like a melodic drop. Like I think vocals on a tune are very important because it draws people in my opinion. Like, oh, they hear like a nice vocal with a female on it. Like, it just soothes the mind and it gets people set up for the drop. So I'm a real sucker for vocals. Mm. So them two tunes are definitely up there. What else have I got? Jamez as well. He's another underground guy who's got a bit of everything, a bit of, you know, sort of rollery liquid stuff. So I mean, it's nice to be, like I said, I've been out of drum and bass, so it's nice to have dig the new stuff, which I haven't been able to do.
People are sending you their tunes now.
And it's nice to like dig the new stuff, like, because I've just been out of it for so long. So but don't ever forget about the old stuff, because I think the old stuff is sometimes better, sometimes not better, but it's important to have a variety of music across.
It is, and it is amazing how, depending on who you're playing in front of, there are some crowds you play a tune that you might think, oh, this is a real dusty HMV tune, you know, and it's like you put it on and no one's heard it. It was like, what's that?
Because it's so odd, and I find that that's actually because obviously I've been out of drum bass for 3 years. Obviously I've got all of that collection, which I'd, you know, like prep my sets and played, and I have all of that, and like, yeah, like when I play a tune, obviously things have moved very fast with drum and bass, with production wise and new people coming in all the time. So yeah, like but again, that's why I'm looking forward to playing the first set, because I have just such a set that people will be like, oh, I haven't heard that tune, or might not have even heard that tune at all. And with the rides, it's, you want to keep, like I say about the vocals, you want to keep like the happy spirits, and some vocals or some bootlegs is very important, like, very important because you've got all ages there, you've got kids that are there, you've got all walks of life are there. So try and keep it as vocally and as bouncy as possible with a couple of hard drops, we're away.
So producers listening to this, get your bootlegs over to Dom
ASAP.
he will make good use of them. And just to wrap this up, I mean, you're in a fascinating stage of your career, be that in terms of building things, be that in terms of DJing, or being, I mean, you know, being a presenter or whatever, you know, it's your life sort of connected to music could go in all sorts of different directions. It really could, and it will. And I just think, don't worry too much about what you're going to do next, because what you're going to do next is going to happen, and it's going to come to you because of what you're doing now.
Yeah.
And what you're doing now is, and the great thing about what you're doing now is that it's different each time.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you're not repeating the same thing over and over, because by kind of necessity, you're drawing followers along with you, like in real time, live, not just like internet followers.
Of course, that's the most important thing.
I was discussing the idea of followers earlier, and most people think of them now as like numbers in a little box on Instagram or TikTok.
Yeah.
You know, forgetting that actually, you know, there was a fictitious guy called Jesus who had loads and loads of followers back in the day.
In tow, literally.
You know, but you're like the Jesus of drum and bass on a bike.
Yeah, you could say that. Just need a bit of longer hair. But
Give it a year, you'll grow it. You know, you've got the beard.
Yeah, hopefully, if I've got any hair by a year's time.
Enjoy these times, and it's going to keep growing. You know, it's I can't wait to see what you're going to do once lockdown is permanently finished.
Over, yeah. Well, yeah, I...
Are you going to survive that?
Hopefully.
Are you going to miss it?
I don't think I'll... it's weird, since we're sort of not out of lockdown now, are we? But I think...
Almost.
I think once we come out of it, I'll look forward to sort of going out to like a rave again, because I haven't really been out to a rave, so I'll still do the bike rides even after lockdown. And I think once we come out of lockdown, it'll be the time for me to go abroad, like you say, and go to more places. I think that will keep it really interesting and really...
That'll be amazing.
Yeah, it'll broaden the horizon.
That really will be amazing.
For more things, so...
Yeah. And I'm picturing you with your reputation and people who know what you've been doing, like, say, in a few months' time or next year, going onto stage to do a static gig.
Yeah.
Only I can't imagine that it would be static. even if you're in a club.
No, I mean, do you know, there has been like suggestions or talks to actually like ride the bike onto the stage, like sort of thing, and come off it. Like that's, we've talked about that. Me and Jordan talked about that. So
yeah, drop down from the rope.
Yeah, like on the
wires,
bike,
yeah.
Pedaling away, like
AT.
Yeah, I'm pedaling it, but it's just drawing the string down as I'm pedaling.
Going across the moon.
Could you imagine?
Yeah.
God.
Amazing.
That would be quite a seeing it just ride on.
That'd be brilliant, wouldn't it?
Make good content, but.
So Dom, thanks ever so much for coming on.
No problem.
Thingcast.
Thank you for having
me. Absolute pleasure
it's
to meet you.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah, I've been wanting to meet you for a while, but yeah. I couldn't because it was lockdown.
Lockdown disaster.
Now
we're out, hopefully.
Now we're actually talking to people and meeting people. It's a nice feeling,
isn't it? That's why the bike rides, I think, are just the emotions on the bike rides and people meeting people. It's just like.
What was perfect was. You were allowed to do that.
Yeah.
People were allowed to exercise.
Yeah. That's when it just came in quite nicely.
And no one was... You can't get within a metre of someone on a bike.
Yeah, not technically.
So it's kind of self-distancing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like, automatically. So, fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wicked. Well, I look forward to speaking to you again.
Yep, hopefully.
In a few months' time.
Yep, we'll see where I'm at.
Wicked. Thanks, Dom.
Great. Take care, mate.
Cheers,
thank you.
Take care.